I'm Reed Hastings, CEO of Netflix, and here are five lessons I've learned over the last 20 years of Netflix. The first lesson is no rules rules. We don't have a vacation policy. You take whatever you want. We don't have an expense policy. You spend as you think appropriate. We have only one five-word principle, which is to act in Netflix's best interest. And with that, we find that employees do amazing things. Lesson number two is that a global company needs a global culture. It's been so exciting for Netflix over the last few years to expand around the world. Now we understand much more how different nations like to give feedback, and it's been very stimulating for everyone at Netflix to be inclusive of all of these different values so that we can work well together to serve our members around the world. A successful culture is one where people can disagree openly and move forward with candor. One of the big mistakes that I made about 8 years ago at Netflix was Quickster, where we separated the DVD and streaming services too quickly. And what I found is that our employees did not feel comfortable telling me that this was a bad idea. Afterwards, we realized it was a bad idea, so we changed our culture to really focus on farming for dissent. It's each leader's responsibility to stimulate people to really say what they think might be wrong. For all of our leaders, including me as CEO, our job is to inspire, not to manage. If you've got high-performing employees, you can broadly set context and focus on inspiration to stimulate the best creativity amongst people to create great ideas that help your company move forward. And the last lesson is to open the books, share information broadly inside the company so people have the information they need to make great decisions for the company. And it's all about freedom and inspiring people to serve our customers.
Netflix research is really our effort to apply scientific techniques to all parts of what we do at Netflix.
We have a rich research and data community throughout Netflix, which is really pushing all of us to be rigorous in our thinking, to be curious, and to always think about what's the best.
We really pride ourselves on bringing in great talent. And when you have such great talent, then you want to give them the freedom to explore.
We give our researchers a lot of leeway to think up their own ideas and pursue their own inclinations for what might be that next big step forward.
The thing about freedom and responsibility that's so great for our researchers is it backs them up when they're curious and when they try to figure out what are the right questions to be asking.
You can get access to the data. You can do things without getting approvals or going through some approval chain. And so that really frees you up and liberates you to deliver just really high value things.
Freedom and responsibility is something we embrace throughout the whole company. And it means that people are very receptive to new ideas that might challenge what's currently being done or might be something that we've never done before.
And the culture essentially allows you to do that. And so especially in research, I feel like freedom and responsibility really plays
in. We will come
really
in
well.
You know, every day knowing that you can have material impact on people's lives in a very meaningful way is very satisfying.
In September 2014, we launched Netflix in France. It was a big challenge with such a skeptical public. The only way to succeed was to be perfectly relevant. Luckily, we have the most adapted tool, Topics Model. Topics Model is a natural language processing system. It can transform a mass of everyday language into significant insights to identify a brand opportunity. We use this text mining approach to analyze 2 years of digital conversations and erase irrelevant data, the surface and the noise. It processed the data into different categories of meaning, sometimes from the same source. We used machine learning to train our algorithm to get better. This unique system enabled us to dive into the French mindset. We interpreted all the data with our knowledge of the local market to come up with three essential insights. The French love culture, but they're among Europe's biggest pirates. They love innovation, but they're skeptical of what's new. They love revolutions, but they're very conservative. Basically, we needed to break conventions without asking them to change. Thanks to Topics Model, we decided to create a platform inspired by you and came up with a creative revolution. A campaign made of gifts, inspired by people's everyday life and typical French attitudes, connecting them to a good reason to watch Netflix. Skeptical? Try the Netflix platform for free. That's spoiler moment. Watch all episodes of Breaking Bad at once. Frustrated by all the waiting? Watch your favorite series instantly. Also, we use contextual data to address them real-time on more than 8,000 screens, when it rains, during the sales, or the holidays. The French identified so much with the gifts, they put their skepticism aside and started to really love the brand. The brand awareness boomed in only 3 months.
The biggest reason why freedom and responsibility drives the success of Netflix is it encourages us all to be big risk takers. So what does freedom and responsibility mean to me? It means three things. One, there's trust. I'm being trusted to make the right decisions in the best interest of Netflix. Number two is self-discipline. I have the self-discipline to exercise good due diligence and good judgment. And the third thing is accountability. I'm accountable for the outcomes of my decision, whether they're good or bad.
Freedom and responsibility to me is the gateway to creativity. When you have someone telling you what you can do and not what you can't do, to me, that's a very liberating framework in which to function.
What I like the most about freedom and responsibility is I think it speaks to the intelligence of people. You're trusting people by default. You step in the company, you're new, we're asking you to be thoughtful, to find the context, but actually we're giving you responsibilities, we're giving you the trust.
I think for me, I try to separate the two. I have the freedom to make the best decisions for the business, for my life, and responsibility is for me to make sure that the freedom in those decisions creates a positive impact for the business, for myself, for my family. That's how I look at it.
Freedom and responsibility means having the autonomy to make my own choices. It doesn't mean that I can do whatever I want.
Think about all the content on a service like Netflix and where all of it comes from. A lot of what you see is made by Netflix, but most of it's not, whether it's network TV shows, old movies, or movies that were just in theaters. A study last year found that licensed content makes up 80% of what people actually watch. Netflix pays to license that content from the studios, and it's a big part of their business. Access to the streaming market is important for studios too, because streaming media is where the viewers are. Netflix added 30 million US subscribers in the past 5 years, and that's coming at a time when traditional cable and broadcast TVs have less viewers every year. But licensing to Netflix, Hulu, and the other services isn't the only way for studios to get their movies online. Next year, Disney plans to launch its own streaming service, a direct competitor to Netflix. Now, Disney's not the only studio trying to do that. Comcast has its Xfinity streaming service, Time Warner has HBO Go. The only way to see the latest Star Trek series is by paying $6 a month for CBS All Access. Everybody's vertically integrating, which means there will be less and less third-party content available to license. If you've noticed a lot more Netflix originals lately, that's why. Even if you can't find Star Wars or Iron Man on Netflix, executives are betting you'll stick around for Stranger Things and BoJack Horseman, just like you stuck with HBO for Game of Thrones. Netflix is slowly cracking down on account sharing too, adding distinct profiles and stopping any profile that streams multiple shows at once. We don't know what the future of streaming will look like yet. The transition away from licensing could be jarring, or it could happen slowly over years. Competition between the new services could inspire a new golden age of TV shows, or everyone could fall back on old tricks and familiar franchises. But whatever happens, the pipeline between the camera and your screen is going to get a lot more controlled. And if you want the same amount of content you've been used to, you're gonna have to pay more.
From the moment you first sign up, Netflix approximates the amount of money you'll spend on their service. This may seem a bit impersonal, but knowing the value of each customer helps guide the Netflix budget on customer acquisition and retention. In business terms, this concept of gain justifying spend is known as customer lifetime value. But how does Netflix calculate your worth? Well, Netflix tracks each current customer and analyzes how often they are cancelling their subscription. This is known as the company's churn. In 2017, the average Netflix customer continued their subscription for 25 months, which meant a lifetime value of $290. So, imagine a customer really liked a particular director, actor, or genre. This means Netflix has approximately $290, minus marketing and overheads, to spend on acquiring or making content with those factors. At first glance, this doesn't seem like much, but when their data shows that 10,000 other people have similar tastes, it explains how Netflix justifies spending millions on original content. Ultimately, knowing the lifetime value of your customers helps guide the appropriate acquisition and retention strategy for your business.
Hello, welcome to Netflix. This is Harsh Thakkar speaking. How can I help you? So this is how I start the conversation with my customers.
The customer service team really is the front line to help our customers get back to the joy of Netflix and streaming.
It's the first people and sometimes the only people that our customers deal with. So if they have questions or problems or are excited about something, we hear it.
Thank you for calling Netflix. This is Christina. How can I help you today?
Hi there. I'm just calling in to offer some Netflix and feedback over the phone.
There are three things that made our approach at Netflix CS different. First and foremost is accessibility.
Easy access is important to us. We want our customers to be able to find us. And live support is really what made a difference for our members.
Usually within a minute, you're connected to a live agent who has your customer information in front of them and can start troubleshooting your issue. And I think of five words that remind me of customer service at Netflix.
Five things.
Passionate.
Passion.
Patience.
Accessibility.
Easy.
Because customers don't like to be on the phone if they don't have to.
Empathy, because at the other end of the call is just a human being who needs your help.
Yeah, I think to be a good customer service representative, you always have to let your personality shine through.
My approach is being human, right?
So I have a really lot of really nice interactions with my customers. Lots of good stories, funny stories.
Yeah, these kind of stories like no internet connection, no surprise, you are on the desert.
One of them that stick with me was this old grandma who was babysitting her grandchildren, and she stopped talking. She's like, oh my God, James pooped his pants.
No.
And I just couldn't stop laughing.
Good.
Avengers!
Assemble.